Bill, it's nice to be back here again.
Yeah, it feels like we're really building some momentum.
The show must go on.
Want to talk to you about understanding how much value your product is going to deliver to your customer.
We've talked about who the customer is, we've talked about how they might use it, and then we talked about what the product is. Now we really have to get down to what value, concrete value, we bring to our customer.
Can you suggest a framework for thinking about this step?
So value proposition is the single most important thing to your customer, and how will you change it from what they're doing today to what they will be able to do with your new product? So what's the difference between the as-is state and the new state that you'll bring them to with your product?
So let's define value proposition.
What is the number one thing your customer cares about? What is it that just keeps them awake at night? What's that burning opportunity, burning problem they need to have solved? And once you understand that you've got the first part, because that's the dimension in which you're going to measure value. The second thing is, what's the as-is state? How do they achieve what they achieve today along this dimension? It could be cost, it could be time to market, it could be, you know, net present happiness. It could be anything that the customer decides. But how do they do it today? And then that's usually pretty easy because you just need to interview the customer. The third part is, what's the possible state that could be achieved with your product?
So let me paraphrase to make sure that I follow you. Value proposition is that number one factor that your customer cares about. It's potentially a problem that they have. The as-is state is how that problem is being solved today.
Or, for example, not being solved if it's an unmet need. And thirdly, it's how you can potentially solve that problem.
Absolutely, but it's how it's solved in that first dimension of what's the most important thing to them. That's absolutely correct. And once you understand those three things, you just need to put them together, and then you have your quantified value proposition.
I'm hearing you say quantified value proposition, not just value proposition. What's the difference?
So whenever you can quantify something, you should try to do that, especially in business. As Lord Kelvin said, you know, if you can't measure something and you don't know what the number is, your knowledge is insufficient. So in business especially, you want to quantify whatever you can. If it's cheaper, how much cheaper? If it's faster, how much faster? If the quality's higher, by how much is the quality higher? If the time to market shorter, by how much? So whenever you can, you should quantify things, and that's why we put that into the process.
It seems to me that your insistence on quantified value proposition versus just value proposition is just another reflection of your methodology that drives toward the holy grail of specificity.
Yeah. And we do that with our entrepreneurs all the time. Push them to really try to make it easy for the customer to buy their product. Do the work for it, because it's not up to the customer to do the work. We should be doing that work for them. And if we do, then buying the product will be a delightful experience. It'll be very rewarding for them. That's why we look at quantifying it.
But also, it's got to be an internal check for the company, for the entrepreneur. Are we really making a difference in a concrete way?
It's one thing to say it without numbers, and then how much do I improve your productivity? A lot. Well, what is that? Is that 20%? Some people, 5% is a lot. Some people, 20%. So we really need numbers here if we're going to be effective.
You teach entrepreneurs now, but there had to be a point in time when
you learned the importance of the value proposition of quantifying it. Tell us about that.
As you know, I started my career at IBM. They understood their customer intimately. And we were trained from the get-go. And there was a phrase, you never got fired for buying from IBM. And the reason why that was relevant is because the data center manager wanted reliability. And that's what IBM would deliver for them in their product. It wasn't necessarily the best technology, but it was the most reliable that you could count on. And it was not just the product, it was all the ancillary services and everything else about the company that will do whatever to make you successful. If your computer goes down, we'll break into the parts store on Christmas and bring the parts back to you to make sure your computer stays up. And that was an excellent alignment of the customer's value and the company's products and services.
Your step on the quantified value proposition follows high-level product specification. I want to understand the reason for this particular sequence.
Before we're going to be able to really start digging into this, we need to understand what the product is. because the possible state is now an incorporation of the product into it. And we don't want to start talking about the possible state without having an internal understanding, as well as an understanding with the customer, what the product is. So now when we start to have that internal discussion about what the value proposition is, we're all in agreement. And then when we have the external one, the customer knows what we're talking about.